Last time, we produced this visualization of the point pattern from the C14 dates. And in this video, I would like to show you a more formal approach to analyze the pattern that are within these data. We can see already from the display of the points, but probably also more clearly from the heat map, that here's some clustering going on, and other areas are much less dense occupied or represented with these sites with C14 dates. And beyond the pure visualization, there are mathematical tools with which we can analyze and quantify this kind of clustering. So this is a matter of point pattern analysis. And here, so this is a whole branch of statistical analysis. The most basic and often most relevant question is, are data clustered? Are they uniform distributed, so with equal distances, or are they random in the sense of complete spatial randomness? You can look up here the Wikipedia page, I've linked that here. This means a process like if you would have a handful of rice and you would throw that over a floor, the kind of pattern that will result from there. Some of these rice pieces, corns, would be more close, others would be more far away. We would have some dense areas and some not so dense areas, in contrast to a clustered or uniform distributed situation. So, and these are mainly the three general structures or patterns that you can have, and point pattern analysis quite often serves to distinguish between these situations. I will not go too much into detail here. We had that already in the course, in the seminar. Just very short. So there are clustered patterns usually results from attractive processes where the presence of one object attracts other objects. For example, at burial sites, usually we have burial grounds, so a lot of burials tend to be clustered in a landscape. On the other hand, regular patterns result from repulsive processes. For example, settlements. If we have a settlement, usually there comes some territory with the settlement, so not in the absolute vicinity of one settlement will be another settlement. They are repulsing each other in a way. And that's why settlements tend to be more regular spaced in the landscape. That's just very rough, crude generalizations that of course do not affect or are not real for every individual case. So one technique to analyze these kind of patterns is nearest neighbor analysis, and specifically the technique of the average nearest neighbor. That's the most basic idea. And this can be visualized with these pictures here. So if we would have a clustered situation, if we look from each individual point to find its nearest neighbor, when we have a clustered situation, most of the time these distances will be rather small, because the nearest neighbor will always be within the cluster, so the nearest neighbor, the average nearest neighbor distance will be small. While if we have a more regular spaced situation, the nearest neighbor will be more far away, because we if all points are regularly spaced, the distance also to all the points is more or less the same, and it doesn't matter any longer what the nearest neighbor is, because all the neighbors are probably the nearest neighbor and we have more distance to the nearest neighbor. We can calculate the nearest neighbor distance by summing up the minimal distance for each point to its nearest neighbor and dividing that by the number of points that we have to get the average nearest neighbor distance. And we can compare that to a theoretical random distance that would represent the complete spatial randomness situation. That can be approximated by using the area of the extent, dividing that by the number of points that we have, take the square root out of that and multiply that or divide that by 2, multiply that by 0.5. This gives you the theoretical random, the theoretical distance to the nearest neighbor in a complete spatial random situation. The approximation, that's good enough for us. And if we compare now our actual nearest neighbor distance that we have in our point pattern to this random situation by dividing our actual situation by the random theoretical distance, we get the nearest neighbor index. And this index tells us if a situation is clustered in general or dispersed in general, or if it's more or less around the random situation. Because imagine, if we would have a clustered situation, the actual distances would be much smaller than in the random situation. So this division would tend to zero, or take any value between 0 and 1. If it would be a random distribution, it would be more or less the same like the theoretical random distribution, so the value would tend to be around 1. While in a more regular situation, the values would be higher than in the random situation because we would have more distance between the individual points. And if we divide that by the random situation, we would get something between 1, 2, I don't know, large numbers. So with this index, you have just one number, which is quite convenient to identify if the general pattern in your data is clustered, random, or regular. There are some downsides to that, and we will come to that with the next video. Okay, how can we do that in QGIS? There is a tool for that, and it's also quite easy accessible. Downside is it's probably not the most user-friendly tool that is in QGIS. But I will show you how it works. So here we have QGIS, we have the pattern and our C14 points, and I have reprojected them to EPSG 2056 as we needed it. So we need a projected system here that we can calculate distances from. And the tool itself is easily available via vector analysis tools, and there are the nearest neighbor analyses. You can see it here in German. In English, it's nearest neighbor analysis. Okay, we can click that. And now the dialog here is very, very simple. We just have to select the input layer. So we use our projected points here. And we are asked for if we want to store that in a temporary file or not. Actually, you will see this file is in the end not a shape file as we are used to, but it will be an HTML file. Okay, we can just leave it like that because we probably don't need to store the result for a very long time. I just click on run, let it process, and now here's your result. You probably don't see that in the first place because usually these algorithms would change something in the map or give you another layer. That's not the case here because the result is actually hidden here. So there's the result pane, and here you can see the result from next neighbor analysis, and here you can see a link that actually links to, I will move this here, links to an HTML file. And if I click that, here is your result. And as I said, it's not very convenient. So it would be nicer if the result would be shown really in the output file or in the output dialog. But here is your nearest neighbor value. So we have the observed mean nearest neighbor distance. We have the theoretical expected mean nearest neighbor distance. If we divide them, we get to this index that is 0.1. It's very close to zero. So we have a strongly clustered situation here. We have also the number of points and another way of expressing this situation with strongly clustered with this set evaluation. I will not talk about this because it's enough that you know this nearest neighbor index. Okay, with that, now we have a tool to analyze the general structure of data. And in the next video, I will show you why this sometimes is not enough and what other tools are available. Although this is more complicated because it's not built in at all in QGIS, so we have to produce our own function. It might also be of interest, but it's advanced stuff, so you might like to use just the nearest neighbor analyzers, and for most of the applications, this also might be enough. See you in the next video.